Smyth, it could be the youngster from Ray, I think, but it was Michael. I don't know that, so Michael Dunlop Print is going to start the identifier. Sure, somebody's going to start the identifier for the Michael Dunlop Print. Five pounds, what about 3 pounds? There's there 3 pounds in the hall, thank you. 3 pounds, Greg Conway. 3 pounds, what about a fiver for the Michael Dunlop Print? Is there five? Did I see a hand up there? No. Yep, fiver it is. Yep, thank you. 5 pounds just in front here. Seven pounds. 7 pounds, a bit of 7 pounds for Michael Dunlop just in front. Is there a tenner for you twice? Thank you very much, Jeff. Sir, ten pounds. Nice. Thanks a lot. Thank you. 3 pounds at the mountain in the street. Another couple of pounds in the hall somewhere. Three pounds for a once at the 3 pounds. Can I get the system part? So we have a small fleece here. I think there is something on there. Well, yep, that is Maxwell. It is indeed. It's a small fleece Maxwell. I've got to be worth a fiver to start. A fiver to start for a small Maxwell fleece. I'm going back of the hall here. 40 pounds. 40 pounds it is. 45. 50. 50 pounds. 50 pounds. That's a nice way to end. 50 pounds. 50 pounds for the beef or two. And the smugglers at the minute is sitting at the back left hand side of the hall. 50 pounds going once. Talking this time last year, you were just starting out in your career, and I remember asking you at the time, at the end of the season, what would you hope to have done, and I think your answer from memory was that you wanted to finish in the top 10, and then I think you maybe had another think about it, and you said you wanted to finish in the top 6. Well, you did better than that, because I think you finished, you correct me if I'm wrong, third in the Irish and second in the Ulster in the Young Guns. So there should be a microphone there somewhere, maybe Hector, a few of them, Andrew, there's a microphone. And Andrew, first of all, congratulations. Maybe we'll give him a wee round of applause, give him a bit of a friend. First year in the third service, and a great job done. So tell me this, you're sitting on the line, it's your very first race, and you're looking down towards maybe Getters at Kirkerson or Lartsfield or whatever it is down at Bishop's Court. What must that feel like in your very first race ever?
It just felt really good and different for a change.
I think when we spoke last time, you had a couple of outings on the little 125 Aprilia, but then obviously your season started in earnest. How did it go for us? Tell us.
Well, my first, I sort of had a bit of a half season, and it was sort of just learning the tracks, and then I thought the start of last season, I was just going to try and go as fast and as hard as I could.
And as far as then the various circuits and battling it out, of course I've lifted the wrong sheet, so we'll get the red sheet here and get things sorted. As I said, was there a favourite track that you had throughout the season, or is there one that you always like to think I'm heading down there today?
I would say it would have to be Lindell, the big track,
because
it's just so fast and
flowing. And on the 125, then you enjoyed the battles, because some of the guys you were battling with there were fairly competitive men, the young lad who used to do a bit of mini motor racing there. I think young Johnny was thereabouts in the mix of it as well.
Yeah, Johnny was really fast, and I don't think anyone answered for him, he was gone.
And as far as the battles are concerned, now you've got 1 year under your belt and you're right in the thick of it, and you're moving now to the 300 class, I think.
Yep.
Tell us a little bit about that. New bike and all sitting up there, Ferrari red, ready to go.
Yeah, so I just can't wait to get out on a bigger bike, go faster.
Well, if I was to ask you, as I asked you this time last year, then what would you hope to be, or where would you hope to be when we're sitting here in another year's time, if we're still all lucky enough to be about here in a year's time, how would you like to go in the 300 class?
I have to say I would like to be in the top 5 again.
Well, you're getting it. He's moving his talents up a wee bit. He definitely is. And it's been short circuits. I don't know if I should ask this in front of mum and dad there, but is it going to be short circuits then for the next little while? Any thoughts of between the hedges at all?
No, it's definitely always going to be short circuits.
Well, there you are. Maybe we could have a wee word with Hector later on as we progress then, and see if we can get you sorted out. As far as the racing last season, was there one particular race that would spring into your mind when you're just thinking about the season, one that you really enjoyed, one that you thought that was a job done?
I just loved every race and every moment.
Well, there you are. That's good. And finally then, have you had a run out on the 400 yet? Or the 300?
I had a run out to Sunflower and it was going really quick. I got a fourth in the class, so that was good.
It certainly was good. Well, look, we'll maybe keep him up beside us here for a little while, or if you prefer to nip back, we can call on you, whatever you feel most comfortable with. Would you be good enough to give young Andre a round of applause, please? Very well done. Much notice, nor did we give Alan much notice, but when I was thinking about what I was going to say about Hector Neill, or ask Hector Neill, I wasn't quite sure what way to tackle it, but I think Hector, what I would like to start with, and say, how on earth did you ever get involved in motorbike racing? Because motorbike racing really has been pretty much your life for so many years. How did you first get involved in motorbike racing?
I mean, if you want to know how I ever got involved, and it was a wee fella at school. I used to sit and mind a motorbike for a man who lived two doors from us. And I was sitting one night and he came out at about 11 o'clock and he says, "You're not in bed?" I said, "No, I was minding this bike." And he says, "Listen, the bike will be still there in the morning." He says, "Come up," and he says, "I'll take you around on the back of it around this old race ground." And once I got on the back of this thing, sort of, the bug was there. And I said, "Jesus, it's some sort." But Mr. Scurry, the people says, "What are you going to do when you grow up?" Like, going to be a saddler. I always said, "I'm going to win the TT." And the boys used to laugh at me. "Win the TT?" He said, "Hey, come." And I said, "That's my idea." And that was there ever since. But never I really got involved. I worked in chambers. I go past with Ralph Brands and Terry Patterson, all the boys.
Of course.
Ralph was always road racing. And I couldn't get my mother to sign for a bike. So I ended up in motocross and I've done a bit of motocross, but in between the higher porches coming and seizing the bike, like, only lost about 3 or 4 to the racing time, but I persevered, and then I met Norman Dunn, and Norman was racing, used to go to another road race with him, short circuit, and coming up to the northwest time, he was due to be supplied by a bike from a fella out of Isabel's in Belfast, who was banned the bike, but he came near the time, no bike, no money, so Norman was disappointed, that's it, finished. I said, "What are you getting?" He said, "He's going to buy me a 350 Yamaha." I said, "Much of them?" He says, "A £3,000 with a spares kit." I said, "Jesus, that's the price of the house." And he says, "Well, that's it, I'm not going to get it." But I had been saving up like mad for to buy a boat, which I wanted all the days. And that was up near 3,000. And I went away and done a bit of counting. I says, "Do I need a boat?" "No."
I said,
"No, I ordered that bike, and ordered it of Danny Keeney in the south of Ireland, and went down and collected it and took it to the northwest." And Robert Moon, you about there, Robert? No,
he was here earlier. So
he was a mechanic. We opened this wooden box and it was full of pistons, cylinders, clutch plates. "This is what I'm going to do with all that." He said, "That's the spurs kit." "I said, when would you use that?" "Well, between the practice and the race, we took the box back with us." Everything else was gone. Seized, I just says, "Right, no, hold on. You're riding the bike from now on. I'm now the mechanic."
Yes.
And that's when I started to work on them. And that was me way back in the late 60s in the motorbike race.
That is
the same. Like
when you started working on it, like, did it
no,
go
on? I've never seized. I never ever. I know how two stroke from.
Did it go fast?
From the 250s and 350 Yamahas right down to the RGs. Never had a seizure.
So it was quick then, yeah.
A lot of quick bikes.
Oh, well, I'd rip on you one day. I wasn't slow. What do you mean, Dad?
I was a mechanic. I
just had them go ahead here. I was a mechanic.
I was a mechanic and all the tuning port and a lot. Yeah. No, very few people know that. So anybody wants to sign me up, like.
Well, Hector, then that was really the start of your involvement in sponsoring motorbikes, I suppose, from then on, because since then, of course, you've been involved with many, many people down through the years. We'll get a little bit closer to the dates in a minute or two, but who are some of the names that you can remember working with in those early days?
Well, it started off, I told you, with Norman Dunn. Then Ivor Greenwood came on board, and after Ivor decided, after he fell off a couple of times, he said, "Enough's enough." I went then, I had Stephen Cole, I had, who else had it? Stephen Cole, was that Manny? You know, what did I have on?
Johnny Ray
wrote for
Norman Brown.
Norman Brown was a good writer. Yeah. And we went on then into the bigger one. Suzuki came aboard and gave us the big, what we called the big contract.
Do you remember them? Are they still going to help you?
Well, they haven't started.
I think we should put a chair between these two, shouldn't
we? Yeah. Well, I mean, it's funny as well. I mean, then brought in wee Ian Lockhart, who really got me to ride the R71 when I built it. And it went from Lockhart then to David Jeffries and Colin Law. No, Colin didn't ride for me. He did Archibald.
Yes.
He won the two TTs for us. And then it just got bigger and bigger up to what's going today.
Before we get to the TAS and then obviously Renatus and Tycho, I know you must have a wealth of stories, and there's a couple you told me once, but I'm not sure if I can tell them in the first Comber Presbyterian Church, but Hector, tell us some of the experiences you had, because not only were you involved in motorbike racing, but in those days it was a real expedition to go to races. It was just a crack and then a day's racing, I suppose.
Well, there's not many stories. I'm going to write a book sometime, there's not many, I'm going to have to put them all down. Because I'm starting to forget them, you know. I was going to the TT one year, and me and Mousy Marr was with me, was Stanley Marr, and his job was to make me a bench to work on the bike. And I said, right, I'm making it. He said, nice, pull it from on the Friday, you go to the boat. And he looked all around outside the house, and he'd come, and he says to me, it's a van open, I says, aye. And he flew out with a bedroom door, coming into the back of the van. I said, not the bench, go, quick, go. It wasn't Marr. He said, she hasn't called on, he's just there's no door in the bedroom. I want the door for the best, that's what we're working on. Which is the bedroom door.
Well, there's more, if we give them a bit of encouragement, there's more.
He won a lot of money in the casino one night. We were standing up in the Inglewood Hotel, up in the Greenwood, and myself and the mouse, and then he comes throwing the pamphlets of £20 notes up in the air. We're all not one, nice to say. Then he turns around and threw my clothes. Trousers, shirt, shoes, out the window, on the street. Not the keys of the car, wait a minute. And I just says, right, mouse, you get down and get them, or I'll throw you out the window after them. So you don't need them, my man, you know, I said, never mind, go and get them. So help me come here and get him calmed down, and he thought he'd sleep out in the window ledge.
Was there any drink involved in this, by the way?
Polax. Greenwood said to me, I'm putting this team, he says, I can't get on steak. He's raving all night, he's not trying to sleep. You heard him talking about it. He jumped up and tipped the bed and threw Greenwood out of the bed up against the wall. Billy he broke his collar, but he said, I can't be this tomorrow, it's all wrong. And then he broke his shoe. But all the guys were on, they lost some time. They stayed up in the Majestic one time, I put them in there. And I was staying down the street because I couldn't get in. And I come up in the morning at 7 o'clock, I looked out the van, I was sitting in the door open. I said, who the hell's in the van? So I flew down, the three of them, my dog, Mouse and Greenwood land back. What's going on here? Greenwood says, you don't want to know. I said, what happened? Amos says, I get into bed. He says, and they were lying giggling, and one of them says, is that my bed's not a bit damp?
Oh,
Amos says, aye, it's damp. He says, aye, where's ours? Is here? So Amos got up and they brought a new pair of Kawasaki overalls. They put the overalls on, got back into the bed again. No battery, says, them beds are soaking. Got the manager up, the manager threw them all out. Found out later on that before Greenwood came in, the mouse threw a bucket of water in the Amos bed. Put the covers over.
That would do it.
They ended up out all night, lying, sleeping in the back of the van. And Amos says, how am I supposed to race? He says, well, that's what I carry on. I said, I can't help it. I says, I wasn't there.
Racing was only an excuse for a bit of crack, really, by the sound of things.
Well, you write a story on what happened between the race and not about the racing.
Andrew, I'm not sure if you should have listened to all this, but we'll carry on. Moving forward a wee bit then, and Hector, and obviously we all know TAS, Temple Auto Salvage, and your association with Suzuki, which I think was around 15 years. Tell us a little bit about starting up TAS and how TAS grew to the team that it is now. We'll come to BMW in a moment.
When I started Temple Auto Salvage, it just was make money to buy parts. Only money I made in, I bought bikes and bits and pieces. And whenever I started up the racing team, Philip said, hey, what are you going to call it? And he said, I'm going to call it TAS Racing. That was what the R71 will operate. What are you going to call that for? I said, listen, Campbell was always TAS. Funny enough, he said it was a great idea.
Oh, there you are.
That's where it started from.
One of your few.
One of the few. How we ever got this Suzuki deal was Tom Hearn was with me at the Northwestern, and I was great pals. and his big truck went on ahead, and he was coming to the TT with me in the transit, and I was taking his two bikes and my RG in the transit, but unfortunately Tom had an unfortunate accident, and that was his life over. But I still took the wreck 750 on the 500 to the TT, and a couple of days later, Rex White from Suzuki and Martin Albert came down to meet me to collect the bikes. And I got talking to them, and Rex and I clicked it terrible well, and they started to help me a bit then, give me another bit and piece, and that started. Then Rex said one day that Suzuki's looking at somebody to run a team for them. What would you need? And I said, I need a couple of super bikes and this, that, and he built them all. So within about 3 weeks, a load of bikes landed, or shipped money more. No documentation, no paperwork, nothing, just there's the bikes. Is that enough? I said, yeah, I'll do it. So I started building. And about 2 weeks before the TT, when I had them ready, Locker was riding them in Archibald. And Suzuki rang me, he said, what have you got on your truck, Hector? I said, it's about Suzuki GB. Oh, no, he says, take that off. It doesn't matter. He says, these are bikes only out, we don't know what they want to do. And if they don't do well, I can lose my job over it. I said, listen, I have tried to tie the bike and test them different sorts out. The bikes will do well. Oh, I don't know. So I didn't take the stuff off. So we had it in the island. Went out and won the 600 Super Sport, Super Stock. Rang him up. I says, the bagger over here, what's up? I said, we just won the first two races. And these are the bikes that you said, but they're no use. So he landed over, and that was a big relationship. Got the guy over from that and just got better. But what happened at the finish was, every year, we put ourselves out to changing these bikes, getting better and better, but nothing ever new appeared. So they told us there's going to be new bikes coming every year, year after year, no super bike, no super bike. But the BMW team came along, and it was too good a deal. So look, you played with us, even said some of the guys from Japan that kind of asked us to stay with the team, but couldn't turn the BMW deal down, and that's where the Suzuki thing ended. Still miss them.
I was going to say, how hard was that for you? Because I think it was 15 years that you had been with Suzuki, and it must have been very difficult to make that decision.
It was very, very hard, but I'll tell you now what made me mind up. We were negotiating whether we would stay or not, but I asked them, could I buy a Suzuki Jeep off them? And normally BMW's giving us each Jeep, but they were selling them to it, and they were giving, Phil Dicey was giving 35% off. I said, well, I don't know. So I needed one for friends of mine in Spain who wanted one. I said, I'd buy it. So I said, would they organise it? They said, they would. I said, right, so I called into the dealer in Marbella. Said, well, what's this? You're the team, man. Yeah, we can sell you a Jeep. He said, we will give you 7% off it. I says, wait. He says, well, it's only 6 normally, but we will give you one more.
That was a big deal.
I just says, thank you very much, walked out. And that clinched. That was it finished. He said, Philip, take the BMW thing. And he says, Suzuki actually offered me 7% off buying a Jeep off. And I says, that's door closed. And I told them that later on. Oh, we didn't know that happened. And I said, well, there you are. And now you know. But that was a finished BMW's come up. We're still there ever since.
It just shows you how these things work out. Over all those years, Hector, you had lots of riders, and am I right in assuming that the race that you always wanted to win, or the race that maybe a major sponsor, especially if you're involved in the road, is the senior TT, is that the one that will give you the most satisfaction, or is it just winning races?
No, the senior TT's the daily. Once you land off the boat in Edamon, put your foot on the Edamon side, you say, right, I'm here for the big one. That was, it's always in your head. I want to win different races, but the big race to win in Edamon, and the one you get the most glory out of, even in your own head, is the senior TT. That's the blue ribbon.
Tell me, the first year that you were in line for that, and I was trying today to find out who it was, and I couldn't, I just didn't have enough time, but you're in pit wall, you're dressed up in all your gear, and you're currently leading the senior TT, and you have a lap to go. What must that feel like? This is your very first senior TT, a distinct possibility.
From biting your nails and praying. You know, you've got your praying over there, touching wood, and you see wood putting on. So we're doing all that, and then Rex White came down to me, because Rick Grant was out of it, he Christ. And he says, Hector, you're in the lead. I said, no, we are. He says, well, look, on the last lap, he says, your bike's smoking in Ramsey. Okay. I said, well, you believe this? He says, I'm afraid it is. But I said, well, just wait and see. But Norman kept holding his place. He lost him around, but not a lot. But coming around Craig Nabar, there was oil coming out of the bottom of the gearbox seat. and got onto the back tower. And the bike went sideways the whole way around the creek. Nipped his thumb and took a big lump of skin through the glove. But he hung on to it. And he came in with the boots all covered in oil. But we knew as they crossed the line that we had won the senior.
Can you explain this all here? Can you give us any idea, after all the years of trying to get there, what must that feel like?
Well, we just ran down into the pit thing and we could not believe it. I said, "Mouse, you not believe it." The mouse, Brian Madol and me, just three guys from nowhere, went and won the senior TT. And we won it by buying quick filling equipment in America, which I knew about. I knew we were going to win it with two pit stops because Honda had quick fillers and all the stuff. I said, "I'm getting them." So when I worked hard for about 3 weeks, I got a bit of money here, and over to America to Daytona, and I said to the guy in the fuel shop, "I want quick film equipment. What do you want to take on?" I says, 7 gallons. "How quick can you give me it?" He says, 6 point something seconds. I says, "That's what I'm looking for." So I paid him for it. It was delivered up to the hotel, and it was all left out in the foyer, and I had a lot of the boxes, hoses, and fittings. And who came in but Keith Carroll from Shell and Barry Simmons. And they said, "What are you doing?" I said, "I'm putting all this." I said, "What's that for?" Keith says, "I says, that there is to win the TT."
Yes.
And Barry Simmons says, "Aye, and I'm going to put a seat in a spaceship in the moon." He says, "Aye, win the TT." He says, "Catch yourself on." He says, "You walked away," and I just says, "Well,
you see, I'll fix you." You
I have to ask you, you were standing there like winning that TT, and you said, "Arnold." Like, I know who you're talking about, but does that everybody know who he's talking about when he said Norman? Do you want to tell?
You tell him.
I didn't mention that the rider was Norman Brown, of course it was. In his first attempt at the TT, he just won the Manx before it. And then I signed him up, but that was his first attempt ever. But the quick film stuff actually done the job, because we never would have won it without it. It didn't take a wee change, nothing. The bike came into the pit stop. I got the tank made down in Crosby, Keane and Kennish. 2 inches into the tank and measure it, it would hold just about 7 gallons. That's what I wanted. And the side loader for filling it and the one on the top were the same diameter. So we knew what was going in was coming out as quick. So the mouse was the catcher on the top and I was the side loader. And I had the thing on banjo clips hanging from the pit wall. As soon as I let it go out of the tank, it went back itself. Didn't have to open it. I was round to the back of the bike. Graham Crosby was supposed to put 2 rags on the 2 tailpipes for me to push the bike. There's no rags on it, so I had to push it with my bare hands on the boiling hot exhaust and 2 big rings burnt on each hand. But the bike was away, and that was us. We knew sure then we had the lead after it. We didn't have it then, but coming up on the third lap, when he got the fuel down a bit, then it was time to go, and that's when we made the ground up. And apart from that, we won a lot more only for that oil seal going, but we're still in enough of a lead up for it to come in and win the senior. And the bike was parked outside the beer tent in the back of the park with, I think, 11 magnums of champagne. The bottles were still tied on the tank. And Rax White was supposed to go to the airport and they couldn't find him. He missed the flight and around to find him out. Lennon had now a hard car, sound asleep. The thinking out of him. But it was a good time for it. All the laurels what we won for all those races. It's all down in the garage, down in Douglas. From all the TS racing, they're all hanging all around all the walls with all the names on them.
Very good.
You walk in and all the time looking and say, "Geez, they really win all this stuff, look at that and all the names." Even Joey's, one of Joey's races is there as well, 2 of them from a Southern 100.
Yeah.
And he won for us in that Suzuki, all in that garage. People come from everywhere just to see. It's like a pilgrimage, so they're all coming, "Oh, that guy." And they read the line, they're all there forevermore. When I'm getting going on Silver Erlich.
Incredible times. Did you ever go back to Barry Simmons and tell him what your quick fillers did for him?
I told Barry Simmons, "You kid yourself."
I'd have been surprised if you'd said no.
I'll tell you a wee story when we're here about the TT. I remember Mervyn Allison, Rossi, David, the Northwest. Joey told me he wasn't coming to the TT. I said, "Well, you may come down over there." So I went down to Norman Dunn's about 2 days later. Hutchinson Square there, and Joey was leaning over the wall looking down at the new guys. He's hand down there. And I went over to him and I says, "Well, Greg, you're here." "Ah, shouldn't you be here now?" He says, "I said, look, I says, what do you like to win?" He said, "Like to win the big one." I said, "Aye, well, why won't he?" I said, "You got any quick fillers?" "Yeah." I said, "You got anything?" "No." "You big tank?" "No." I said, "Well, then you've no chance of getting it in a million years." And I said, "It was Honda have all the quick fillers for granted and have them the whole lot of sort." Really? He says, "I said, I know, I suppose he saw McClamis," I says, "he has a 350 Yamaha tank. Give borrow him, don't tell him what you're going to do with it. And I says, bring it to me. And he says, I knew a big tank, you knew you had a big tank for the mics for Ronnie Russell before that, see. And I says, yeah, huh? So when he brought me the 350 tank and I took it down to Crosby Kane and Kennish to make mine, and I said, look, I want you to put 2 inches into this tank. Who's it for? I says, I can't tell you. Yeah, we're not doing it. I says, no, it's for Joey to laugh. I says, he can win this race, but it's got to be a cap quiet. All right, we'll do it. £47, he charged me for doing it. I took it away. It was just two big strips of aluminium welded around. Tested it, measured it, it was perfect. So took it back to Joey. I said, right, take it away now, get it done up. Me and Nick filled it in,
sure,
and painted and stuff. I don't let anybody see it. I said to the friend, I'm running the race. I went down to the paddock. The tank's sitting on the bike, not painted, two shell stickers stuck on it. I says, I don't believe this. I warned him, I says, right, you're here now. I says, now see this tank, it's going to take a lot longer to fill this. Don't put bully in the pit crew. I says, wait and wait and wait. Take the first lap or so, slow, you get the fuel down. And then I said, when it comes to the pit stop, same again, slow down, but you're going to get two final laps here to finish. You can win this. So we've done the job, away we went. And then come for the pit stop, and Joey's looking, and the man's filling away. Up you come, out. And of course, that time, whenever they come on the second lap, they say, they're coming in for the pit stop. Here they come. There's Grande. There's the Joey by the back, because he had to kind of run with a big tank with fuel on. So Joey finally went on down through, and the commentator says, you'll not believe this, ladies and gentlemen, but Joey Dunlap has missed his pit stop. He's gone through and he hasn't stopped. Oh, what a disaster. And I'm standing, and Barry Simmons is standing up the pits, looking at me like the devil. I knew you would be a rat. I says,
I like the devil.
He's a little face of Simmons up there. And I was from the stage. Caldwell was still helping Joey. And Joey was on through, and after a while, Joey's in the lead. In comes the bloody boys for their second pit stop. They're back in front again, but when Joey's finished made his, then he had the field obstacle. So by the fourth lap, Joey's back in front. Never was having the disappointment.
Yeah.
And now the fact that Mick Grant says was made up out of scrap.
All gone down to the pepper tank.
And now down to the big tank. And it was £47, and I never got the £47 then.
Hector, we'll give you a wee rest for a minute, and that'll give you an opportunity to pick out a couple of war stories. We'll go down. We'll go down to Alan, and Alan, thanks very much. I know you didn't get much notice to be here tonight, but thanks for coming. They just want to talk away themselves here. Alan, the same question, really, as I started with Hector. Obviously, the Irwin family is steeped in motorbikes and motocross and road racing and short circuit. But how did it all start for Alan Irwin those years ago?
Oh, me. Hey, you could have took me first after this.
We're stacking big things here now.
Like most people, my dad would have took me like the Ulster Grand Prix and things like that, and we hung out of the hedge and them days on the way out of Wheaters. We were health and safety, you wouldn't want us where we would have been. And like Hillwood, and my dad would have been a Hillwood fan, and Ivy, and they were coming past, and he says, see that, Mark? And when they were coming out, we were right there, like,
you know. Comes away,
yeah, and Ray says, he says, every lap, right out the edge, sure enough, and I says, this one, he not hit it every lap. So that was the start of me, really, with bikes. My uncle motocross, they would have went in that one, was a kid and watched him.
And the first bikes and the first race, then how did it all evolve?
Well, it all started, we run about Monkstown where I lived, and the out bikes in the field and that. Then we got road bikes, and we went to McCabry to watch Abe Alexander, he had white leathers and all that.
That's right.
Stood out and out there in them days. And the crowd was all said, oh God, I can go faster than that. You know, but maybe not him, but some of them. So that's really how that started. And then I done that finger in an accident and work, and I got a few quid.
Away we go.
One day I come to the back gate in the house and opened the back gate and waved in a 200 Suzuki, and my dad looked out and says, you bought a bike now? I said, yeah. Says, hope you bought a tool kit. He says, ramble up on my way. What's he did do, like? And that was really a start. The next thing was a cap breaking down. And he unlocked the tool kit after a week or so, like, but he said to me, what's wrong with the bike? He says, it keeps breaking down. And I says, it needs electronic ignition. And he says, how much is that? I says, it's £120.
Fortune.
I was earning £15 a week, £120 was a lot of money. And I got up in the morning, this wee envelope on the mantelpiece, and just says, do you want to get up to Lottie? And £120.
And that was it. And the first race and the first success. When did that come?
St. Angelo. Went there in a pair of leathers, truthful. A boy had been cut out of him. And we were all like stuck the blue. Oh, really were like.
Well, your career, and you started between the hedges stuff as well. Did you ever, was there a stage when you thought, this is for me, I prefer the roads to the short circuits, or was it always a mix?
No, well, when I first done roads, I was like you'd sort of relax because nobody expected me to do anything. On tracks, I was riding hard and roads, I was chilled out. And then I suppose, I took the Ulster Grand Prix in Clancy in the Northwest Series. An odd time when I rent for Danny, he wouldn't let me do the road, so if Danny went on holiday, I went to the Mid-Anton.
Could he not read the paper? No, he couldn't see.
Oh, no, I read the paper. I read the Radak when he got back. His bark was worse than his bite. And and then the Regal started, which was sort of serious then. So.
And of all those races, the short circuits, the roads, and is there a particular year, was there a particular time when you thought, I'm here, I've made it, I'm motoring here?
I sort of started getting a liking for roads as well then. And I like corridor, I always thought I could win at the corridor. I liked them all. I won at the Mid-Antrim and the Regal one day, and I think I was sort of shocked. And me and Brian Reid always did good on good, and it was a bit greasy. And it was me and Brian, I forget who it was. Anyway, Brian waved me by. I thought he was waving me by to let me sort of win it. It's not like Brian used to know, it's a pound note at the end of it, Brian wanted it. Talking about joining up our family, Brian Reid, be a wee bit like that.
I would
probably
so,
I come to the last lap, Brian passed me again, and I realised then it really was a race. So I won it, and that was actually, well, the first proper road race. I won the 50 mile race in the corridor, on the unlimited race, but I didn't even know I won it.
Yeah,
so it was only after, really. But that was the first of Temple.
And then you went on from that to win many races, short circuit and road racing on different bikes. Was there ever a year, was there ever a bike that you were riding that you thought, yeah, this is a machine, I can do some damage here?
The 500 Honda. We went to the Northwest. My 500 was an RS. And the Hector, although you have an NS, which is a factory 500 yeah. Honda, and an RS it's a race bike, but the difference basically was an RS was more brake horsepower, like it was a factory bike, a race bike, and it had three power valves and an ignition to suit it, and that where mine had two, but it still went good. But in practice, I was faster than Joey on his Formula One bike, but not on his 500. But Joey had to ride his Formula One bike in the first race. So I thought I could win it, but a long story, I don't know, Joey, I'd done the gearbox on Thursday night, and there wasn't many RS or 500 Hondas about at the Northwest. And I went down to Joey. I said, Joey, I felt I actually broke a tooth out of third gear. I says, have you any gearbox bits? He says, should I? He says, he says, call down to the house tomorrow. I says, what, in the morning? No, in May. I says, he says, leave it to 2. I said, 2 o'clock? And so people would say, like, Joey did work late at night, but he also slept half a day. So I arrived down at Joey's at 2 o'clock, and I was dandy on my bike belt. You know, I was panicking in case he hadn't the part, but he didn't. The parts of Joey, like, you're 47 pound, and my tires are Kirkston, though I had a brand new run in just. Joey would come over and borrow it, and we'd never say much to you, you know. Thanks, you know, the way it went. But he totally rebuilt my gearbox. He stripped it to pieces, sprayed every gear, crack tested it, built it. Easy £1,000 for the gears he put into it. Like, I mean, not like, and built it. And says, who you are? I says, how much do you, Joey? No.
And this was your major competitor.
Oh, yeah, and he knew it. It was actually him that told me I was faster than him when he was having the ride. And he totally rebuilt that box. I says, how much? He says, no, where you go? So that was all right. Anyway, it's a long story. Went to the line. I'm sitting there without done the warm up lap, and go around the warm up lap, and just heading up the coast of Stars Rain. And I says, flipping hell. Excuse me. And I the front wheel, I had him as a 17-inch front wheel because my bike come with 16. It was hard to ride it. And Joey lent me the 17-inch wheel. And I come to the line, and they're up. Joey's bike's up on the stand. Mike Grant's there. I was second on the grid. Mike Grant up onto the stand, and I'm sitting there, and Don, the mechanic, says, it's raining, like. That's Slick's front and rear hacking. And Don says to me, what are we going to do? And I says, what can we do? I says, well, no wheels. He says,
they're stuck.
It's raining. I says, I'm getting smarter, Don. He says, do you want me to take the wheels off and run the Billy Grant? I looked over my shoulder, and Billy Grant
right up in the back of
the bed. I says, Don, I don't think you can do it. He says, you wouldn't have time. He says, what are you going to do? I said, well, look at Mick Grant. He's got his wife back up in the stands. He keeps looking at my wits and looking at his. I said, he thinks I know something he doesn't. So he says, you're not going to ride that, are you? I says, you're ready on. He says, you're mad. I says, don't. I says, I think if I can get enough heat in these slicks to make it work.
Yeah.
So, truthful, like, the first lap, I'm heading again along the edge of the road. Well, most roads that go that shape. So I was sitting close to the white line, and once got heat, and them actually worked.
Yeah.
Mm. You know, they really did. Like, I was sitting, that was maybe fourth or fifth, but like, I was a bit hurry. Like, it's like they're heading towards Mathers Cross, and they're coming on that. You don't really, you know, ooh.
Is this going to work or not?
But the bike was quite in a straight line, and the tires did get heat, and after the first lap, it started drying a bit. And
you knew all this, of course.
Mick Grant really caught this on that. That's like, you know, I was a weller for him. So third lap, I was singing. The bike was going, tramping. I come up over the hill towards the magic roundabout, and there was Joey Leighton going round the roundabout. And I says, I can win this. Joey had intermediates on. I had slicks. He was on the four stroke. I was quicker than him in practice. The track was like this stage, we were getting their knee down, you know, it was getting brave. And I went round the roundabout, and I came out of the roundabout, and I started to put the throttle, and I went off a cylinder. Dirt went off.
Oh, God.
And I was sitting along tour, Hector, you know, the race is over, like, sitting, turning along, heading the whole way, right up towards Mathers Crossing, was heading to Mathers, nice time, and started firing it. I took him on the 3-7, and away I went, I was still sagging at that stage, like, and I finished that.
You're not in a hurry home, are you? Because that's what I'm saying, what a hell of a
race. What about the rest of it? The rest of it was a bit boring. Joey was long gone and finished second, but I actually thought I could have won that. I believe I would have won if I had him an awful cylinder.
There you are. Give him a round of applause for an awful cylinder. And before we make it from back to Hector, obviously moving forward at a pace now, four sons but three involved in motorbikes, of course. Graham, I know very well, riding for a Bill Bass Honda. You've got of course, Graham and Andrew, and as a father now, and I have to say, I'm asking this for a reason, maybe Margaret, you shouldn't listen to this, but at the Northwest a couple of years ago, when Ben was really motoring and right there as far as the 600 race was concerned, that must have been difficult watching that, because it was one heck of a race.
It was really difficult. I have a photo in the house, and it's Glenn on the line, and I would openly say, I don't encourage Glenn to road race. It might sound bad because I've done it, but when it's your son, it's different. And when I say that, they're asked Brian Reid to take him round. He says, no. He says, you take him round. So in the end, I did take him round. I will explain this. I saw him when he came out of Juniper. I says, just in case you're with something, I says, hug the left hand, notice you go past the caravan site, keep in close, don't let it out, hug it the whole way around. I says, you want to go out, don't go out. Mm-hmm. I says, because if I was behind you, I'd be waiting on you going out to go the inside.
Sure.
Put them to the outside. I says, remember, hug the curb, don't let it. So Ben went off in the race, and on the line, I give him five and grab my hand. I actually held his hand.
Mm-hmm.
And it shows you this in this photo. So anyways, the race, as you say, I can totally get the line.
We wouldn't have noticed.
as the race went on, it was a brilliant race. And I'm not saying it because it's Glenn. He's done fantastic.
It is.
First time there. And over the comment, you have this bit and you're panicking. But you also have that other bit and you're buzzing.
Of course.
You know. And come the last lap, and you're watching on the big screen in the pits, and you're watching it, and he's coming up, and the Black Hill, sorry, that's where I was talking about Black Hill, and you come over Black Hill, you hold it tight on the left, and you come over Black Hill, and I'm standing with Glenn's girlfriend, going, tight, keep it in tight, Glenn, tight, tight, and he left 4 foot. I went, let me, and there was Sadie behind me. I know, man. He's fine. Yeah. On your bloody
scissors.
I don't
know what you want. That is so big. Hang on, hang
on. It shouldn't win a race. And they're like, and that actually said he was the only slipstream that Kawasaki in. All right. And Glenn just left that gap, and it gave Alistair the opportunity to go to the inside.
Had the lane.
And Lee Johnson's not stupid neither, because he was right up the inside as well. And to be honest, if you actually any has watched that race, Lee Johnson apologised to Glenn after. Because when it come to the braking, Glenn had actually, Pat, you were so lucky. Glenn had actually passed Alistair braking. And there's again, though, that yes, right. Alistair says he is the best.
Mm-hmm.
Just in case we'll have to remind you. Glenn had actually, this is actually true. Glenn was actually in front, even though he'd come down the outside. And as they were coming down the chicane, probably some, it might have even been on him there. Lee Johnson went up between them, but Lee went up too quick.
Yeah.
And Lee was trying to stop. Glenn couldn't get in because Lee had come past. Glenn.
Close the door on.
And Lee went straight. But Glenn actually made it in the end, sort of, but he was really, really wide.
Yeah, yeah.
And lucky man here, the officer got the clean run through the inside. But a great race.
Oh, super race. I'm coming near the end. Obviously, Graham last year had two championships, fourth in the Maxis and ready for the Dave Thorpe Bill based Honda team. A good season all round. Just so disappointed with Desert Martin. Yeah, everybody fired up and we thought, sure, we were on for a British Championship race win, and just that little bit of a slip.
I thought so myself. I watched Graham in England last year. I thought he was riding, he was awesome, he really was. He was riding brilliant, and he really wanted to win at Desert Martin. And I think he had done everything.
Absolutely.
He just caught that post.
Just a split second.
Just one of them things.
And then Bishop scored, obviously, there that the Sunflower and the Irwin family had sort of cleaned up on a lot of pressure on Andrew, because obviously Glenn had won the two big bike races, and then it was really down to Andrew to pick up the 600s, and pick them up he did.
I thought you weren't going to let me get a word on that.
You must be joking.
Yeah, me and Margaret, after Bishop's Court, I had to drop the camper they were staying in off from Crosscar, and we dropped it off, and we got into the car, and the two of us felt so proud. You know, it was a brilliant day to win the five big races, Hector. Oh, you know where it was. To do that, and honestly, till we felt so proud, and we rang up Glenn and we rang Andrew separately just to let them know, because I was a great feeling, mate.
Most of it, yeah, most of it. Great day.
And like, Hacker was very good, like, he came up and shook my hand, his eyes were still so well, also, I have to say this, because you might ask me this, because Graham's a motocrosser, but Graham read this at court the year
two
before.
2 years, and I did indeed.
And he read for...
Wilson Craig.
Yeah,
Wilson Craig.
Which, Hacker will understand this, when I say Wilson's a road race team. You know, and when you come to a short circuit, it's different, you know, set up, like, they do get tacky all around them places. And Graham, I was helping Andrew because somebody had to leave me. And Graham was on his own, and Graham started off on the Saturday morning with a new set of tires. And Graham finished Sunday afternoon. The same set of tires, yeah. He started on Saturday morning. And he finished that super bike race right on the tail of the Irish champion. He'd never raced till the Wednesday where I took him to Kirkus in an Andrew 600.
Yeah.
I thought he'd done absolutely fantastic.
Did indeed. Ladies and gentlemen, for the time being, Alan Irwin, we'll come back to Hector for a second. This was only supposed to be 15 minutes, that was an hour and a half ago, but we'll have to start much earlier.
I'm just going to get warmed up.
Hector, of all the years on the TAS, they obviously the relentless, and Tyco, and all the successes, you've had a lot of riders through the team, and all sorts of highs and all sorts of lows. For you, as you're driving home some night, what were the highs?
Well, one of the first highs really was with Ivor on the Suzuki, beating Tom around Dundrum on that Suzuki. Everybody says Tom Hearn gives you that one because you're her mates. Mm-hmm. But I went back from that night perfect. Tom, did you or did not give Ivor that win? No. I couldn't afford to give Ivor the win, he says. He was real crafty. He says, he came running. You're a bit was quicker than mine out of the hurt, and he says, and I knew.
First press with there, I come working here, Tom.
I can follow him up, he says, to last right hander around Dawson's, and he says, and he runs down away, and I have the party then on them. And he slips seeing them right around the green and didn't move out. He stayed in and Tom tried to get out of the room, but the bike didn't mind a little bit more tall than his. And he says, that's how I lost the race. He says, Greenwood kept his shoulder on the glass right round the whole last right hander.
Make him go round the outside.
Make him go round the outside.
It's a long way.
But that was very nice highlight, but I think the next biggest one had have been with Norman Brown winning the season.
Of course.
You can't beat that up later to standing in the winner's enclosure. We were back up in the, put them up in the stand that time, and champagne flying. I said, you know, I'm asking, I think I'm dreaming this here, this is going to be real. Three men from Belfast.
Yeah, some wonderful memories.
That's all the memories.
And some of them not so good. Is it fair to touch on that? Because obviously you've had difficult days as well, very difficult days. And how hard is that for a team owner to pick the team up to get going and keep things motoring the way it should be? It must be quite a difficult task.
It takes to be as hard as anything, because I'll tell you why. When it happens to you, you've given this guy a motorbike, and unfortunately he lost his life on it. But if he wasn't riding one of my bikes, he'd be riding something. That guy's not going to start racing motorbikes.
Probably riding something not anywhere near as good, and probably having to try a lot harder.
They're going to ride the bike anyway, but one of the sad days we ever had, and I still remember it, when David Jeffries had the accident and they had him on, we were starting to take the awning and stuff down. For the home, guys, I have enough of this time out here. I'm starting to take it down, and Mrs. Jeffries, his mother, came walking up the paddock, and she says to me, "What are you doing?" I says, "We're taking the show down. We're very sorry about David, and we're going home." "Indeed, you are not going home," she says. "Don't you even think about that." She says, "You get that show up again." And she called Adrian over and says, "Adrian, go you out there," she says to him, "and you win a race for my David. Do you hear that?" So there she went, and I couldn't believe how stern she was to deal with this. The way she demanded that the show would go back up again. And Adrian went out and won the two big races, and that's one of the things that always. It's in the head for everyone, you'll never forget that. So it's good days and bad days, but these things happen in motorbike racing. You don't want it to happen, but if it does, you can either pack up and walk away and go home, or stay in and get on, which I have done. So we've had a lot of happy days since that, so let's hope they stay for 2017, because I better win that senior game.
And then, and as far as 2017, obviously, I hope I get the pronunciation right for short charity. We've got, is it David Giuliano, I think, or something along? Obviously, then staying with his name just escapes me at the minute, and the short charities, young man who used to race supermotors, Christian Eden, and obviously then Ian on the roads. Is that about it, or is there more names to come? Or?
Well, we still need an all-rounder for the Northwest. There's a whole lot of names been bandied about, but the minute I've stepped back and said, and people ringing me, "What about Siri in your bikes?" I said, "Listen,
what about me?"
It's all
right. Everyone's going to make a return.
Just sign me up for
the job. Well, no, we're looking at another, but we will be running probably feeding an all-rounder for the Northwest, but at the minute, there's nothing concrete. We're trying to find out, you know, if you could get Sydney, which we haven't got.
Is it money you're requesting about the
money? Money, yeah.
Yeah.
It's good amount of money to put on the bill.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Hector, before we wrap up, is there one final story left? I'm hesitant because we lost a good friend this year, Ronnie Donnell, and you told me a story once about the Irwin on a chemist shop, but I don't think in First Presbyterian Church somehow we could go there, but there must be another story.
Funny story going about Joey. We were going over to the Shell Awards, and he had to go to the Isle of Man first of all to get something to do with Manx Ladders. So he says to me, "Would you go with me by the end of the night?" I said, "Well, aye. Where can we stay?" I said, "I have people who own a house." So I rang them up and it says, "Yeah, you can use the house for the night, stay down in the middle bedroom, and the keys will be left for you." So we goes to Manx Ladders, got the thing done, back to the house, and we're sitting in the room, and about 9 o'clock, Joey says, "We should go to bed, eh? We're starting early in the morning." I said, "Well." So we're laying in these two beds. He's on the outside one and I'm there. And I looks at the watch. "What time is it, Joey?" "It's about 10 o'clock. I says, "Any time now, she'll be passing through the hall." And he says, "Who?" I said, "The man to tell you, this house is haunted." A ghost of an old scullery maid that you built on the far side of the house comes through early in the 10 o'clock through the big house to service the fires and stuff. "Are you joking me?" I says, "Oh, I'm going to joke you." What did I start? He wouldn't put the lights out. He got up and he put a chair to the door. I says, "I'm only joking you. Oh, you're an idiot, kidding me. I ain't going to your house." Then I had to go and give him the inside bed. I sat on the outside bed. This went on the whole night. I got up at least more than 7 o'clock and then went on to sleep. So it's one of the stories I tell about Joey and the ghost. And I wish the hell I'd never answered them.
Listen, thanks very much. Give Hector a round of applause. I'm so sorry, Andrew, we're left you sitting here listening to all that crap, but a lot of years time, you have some of these stories as well. Tell us about where's your first race of this season coming up then?
It'll be Easter, sort of.
I'm looking forward to that, obviously. Getting nailed down again.
Oh, I just can't wait to get back out in the bike. It's been too long.
I can see it by looking at his face. It's just bursting there, ready to go. And we wish you every possible success. I'm sorry you had to listen to some of these stories from all our yesteryears, but I think everybody enjoyed it. And thanks to Dennis, because it was Dennis who actually got Alan and Hector here. And really, we could have stayed here for another hour, I'm quite sure. But maybe we could have to... We'll ask him back. Will we ask him back next year? We'll have him back next year. We'll have a part two then. So please, if you want to give a warm.
Hector's up. Didn't get penny, said I. Said I got penny. Anyway.
Now he's starting. I may guess it'll come. Give a warm round of applause now. Hector, Andrew, very good man. Thanks ever so much, Andrew Smyth. Thanks very much indeed. Thanks all for coming down. Thank you.
You need a couple of years, man, from there?